second part of trade in the 17th century. Today, I will focus on explaining the ceramic trade. Ceramics were a major commodity for trade in the past time. However, unlike other commodities, they can show as a condition of historical relation in the past, even when broken or thrown away. By archaeological study of ceramic shards, we can reconstruct the trade connection of the past times. A large part of trade, ceramics were manufactured in East and Southeast Asia. Therefore, I will tell you about finding such ceramics in Taiwan and Southeast Asia. As in the previous volumes, again, in this map, I will show you the basic condition of trade relations in the east half of Asia at around the 17th century. In short, East Asian ceramics were brought to Southeast Asia via Taiwan. And in the opposite direction, Southeast Asian spices were carried to East Asia via Taiwan also. In this, the first chapter, I will explain to you the basic condition of ceramics findings in Taiwan. In this map, I can show you several important places in Taiwan related to the ceramic trade. They are Anping in Tainan, Zhuoying in Kaohsiung, Penghe Island, and Jiulan site in Iran. First off, the important ceramic shards of this period were found mainly in the former Hunshan World City site, which is located at Zhuoying in Kaohsiung. This area already started its history after the Zhenzhenguang period. And until the beginning of the 19th century, the Hunshan World City was located in this place. Therefore, in the present times, we can also see several ruins of the World City. At around 1988, On the inside of the World City, an archaeological excavation research project was carried out by the Academia Sinica, as seen in these pictures. This research had an important purpose in understanding the living conditions of common people during the Qing occupation period, and became the first trial for research of historical archaeology in Taiwan. During the several times that research was carried out in this site, a large number of ceramic shards were found, and were the main artifacts gathered from the excavation. Among them was Chinese porcelain, which had an important meaning, because the dating of the manufacturing was relatively clear. These two pictures show you the typical Fujianese blue and white porcelain from the 18th century. Bowls and dishes used as common tableware, as well as spoons, were also found, such as shown in the right picture. However, the most important finding was the Anping jar in the left pictures. This small porcelain jar was produced at several kilns in Fujian, and this jar was brought to Taiwan in the 17th century in the massive quantities. This jar was first discovered in Anping and is therefore called the Anping jar. This is the only ceramics which use a place name from Taiwan. As tableware, many kinds of Fujianese porcelain were found, such as can be seen in the right picture. This type was also manufactured in the 18th century. However, in this site, another brand white tableware was found, which is shown in the left picture. These three shards are Japanese heathen porcelain and date back to the late half of the 17th century, at the time of the Zen government. These are the first findings of Japanese porcelain in Taiwan. Undoubtedly, Zealandia Fort in Anping, Tainan, is the most famous historical site in Taiwan. However, a large part of this Dutch-made fort has broken down over the years, and only the long brick wall remained in a similar condition as during the Dutch period. After the beginning of the 2000s, archaeological research was started in these fort ruins, and the ruins of the Dutch period were discovered here, such as in the right picture. By this excavation research, several shards of ceramics from the Dutch period were found. For example, these four shards in the left picture are a small part of crack-style porcelain dishes made in Chinese Jinduzhen, such as shown in the right picture. This style of porcelain was made with a special order of foreign traders, and in a large number, they were exported from China to other areas in the first half of the 17th century. Because Zealandia Fort was continued to be used after the Dutch period until the Qing period, there were also shards of Fu Chinese Tehua blue and white dishes found here, such as seen in the left picture. Besides Jinduzhen kilns, Tehua kilns also acted as an important role for exported Chinese porcelain, especially to the Southeast Asian market in the 18th century. By such condition, Tehua ware shards with the same motif were found in Banten Lama site in Indonesia, such as in the right picture. As another type of remarkable shards, two small stoneware shards in Zealandia Fort were found, as shown in the left picture. This is a part of a large bowl of Japanese hidden stoneware named Karatsu ware, and is from the same collection as those in Indonesia seen in the right picture. This stoneware was also exported to the Southeast Asian market via Taiwan. Penghu Island already acted as an important relay point for trade between China and Southeast Asia after the 9th century. For evidence of such a condition, a large number of Chinese Yue ware was found. Recently, we have other data related to the trade condition of the later period. It is thought that among them, the finding of small Japanese hidden porcelain shards in there is also a remarkable fact. Ordinarily, these shards form the crack style dish such as seen in the right picture. In the second chapter, I will talk about the trade condition of Chinese ceramics in the 17th to 18th centuries. We have a lot of data for export of Chinese ceramics, including both Jinduzhen ware and Fujian ware in the east half of Asia. These pictures show you the present condition of Jinduzhen in China. In here, the first production of ceramics had been started in the 10th century. After that time, ceramics manufacturing had not stopped even until the present time, and especially after the creation of blue and white porcelain from the 14th century. This town became the best production place in the world for both quality and quantity. Yuan ceramics are very famous for their blue and white style, with excellent lighting motif and pure blue color. a couple of bottles dating back to 1351 are especially well known as typical complete ones, such as seen in the left picture. In this early period, a large number of good blue and white porcelain were carried to the Islamic court in Asia, including those found in Delhi, India, such as in the right picture. After that time, a large number of Chinduchen ware were almost constantly being brought to Asian countries, both as gifts and as trade goods. Blue and white dishes with Arabian characters of the 15th century, as seen in the left picture, were found in the Ardabil terrain in Iran. Also, polychrome kundi, a purring vessel with the Hummbad style of the 16th century, was carried to Topkapı Palace in Istanbul, Turkey. As a good example of Chinduchen porcelain for export, we have many archaeological data in and outside of China. Among them is a finding from a wrecked ship, Spanish ship, the San Diego, which sank off the coast of Manila in 1600. It is very useful for understanding the condition at the end of the 16th century. By underwater archaeological research, many of the Chinduchen porcelain were found, such as a kundi purring vessel for Southeast Asian. In the left picture was a clock style dish for Europe in the right picture. Besides Chinduchen, kiln in Fujian also acted as important role for the ceramic export from China to Southeast Asia. Among the Fujianese kilns, Changzhou porcelain was exported from Yuegang port, which can be seen in the right picture. It dates back to the middle of 16th to middle of 17th centuries. After Changzhou ware stopped being exported, porcelain made in Dehua, as seen in the left picture, was increasingly used for export from Amoy. These two pictures show you a typical Changzhou ware collected in the Jakarta National Museum. A large part of Changzhou ware was made as a copy of Chinduchen porcelain, with blue and white or polychrome glaze. Although the quality of Changzhou porcelain is inferior to Chinduchen, many of them were brought in Southeast Asia and also Japan. Among them, we can see special motifs such as Arabian script with polychrome in the left picture or a blue and white junk sailing in the right pictures. If we compare the condition of Changzhou ware with Dewa ware, Dewa ware was exported to a wider area around the first half of the 18th century. The Indian Ocean area was also a part of its market. I could find many examples of how widely spread they were distributed, such as a mushroom motif dish in Istanbul, Turkey, or the simplified script motif dish in Bijapur, South India. The Tewa kilns produced not only superior quality products, but also inferior quality porcelain. The later one was manufactured in massive quantities, and the other kilns in Fujian also made copies of them until the first half of the 19th century. inferior quality blonde white wools were exported with a large number of them being found in Ho Chi Minh, Vietnam, as seen in the left picture. The rough writing spoon was also exported to Singapore, which is shown in the right picture. In this third chapter, I will explain the export of Japanese ceramics from around the same period. Japanese porcelain hidden ware was produced in the Arita Kirin on Kyushu Island and exported in the second half of the 17th century to Southeast Asia to places such as Banten in Indonesia via Anping in Taiwan. Hidden porcelain was manufactured by Korean craftsmen at Arita in the beginning of the 17th century as the first porcelain in Japan. After that time and until today, Arita has acted as a superior porcelain town in Japan. The products are divided by the export style and the domestic style. In the restaurant of this town, we can enjoy a lunch set served with many kinds of small porcelain, such as in the right picture. In Arita, we can find a memorial for a Korean craftsman, Lee Sampyeon, who first started porcelain manufacturing here. During the early period in the first half of the 17th century, the product of porcelain in Arita were deeply influenced by the Korean style with a rough writing motif such as seen in the picture on the right. However, after the 1650s, porcelain made in Arita was drastically changed and its motif became similar with the Jindochen porcelain style from the late Ming era. For an example, I will show you two findings of hidden porcelain in Banten, Indonesia. The left one is a copy of a Jindochen clock style blonde white dish, and the right one is a large cover with very good lighting and coloring. These were exported to Southeast Asia instead of Jindochen porcelain, which decreased in production due to the outbreak of a civil war. In the same period, craftsmen of Arita succeeded in manufacturing polychrome ware, which was never produced in Korea. The early polychrome ware was decorated with Japanese motifs such as seen in the left picture, but the later one was manufactured with an additional value on the copy of Chinese porcelain such as in the right picture. The basic motif of this dish is karak style, but all of Chinese karak style was only made with blonde white. In the first half of 18th century, when Chinese porcelain was again exported to many areas, a unique style of hidden porcelain was created with polychrome motif such as shown in the left picture. This style was produced for the European market, and the trade was managed by the Dutch. In this condition, a large number of hidden porcelain in 18th century remained in Indonesia, such as shown in the right picture. For the last chapter, I will introduce the trade of Southeast Asian ceramics. Southeast Asian ceramics were only made in the continental area, and among them ceramics manufactured in the Chu Dao Kiln of Vietnam, Si Sachen Lai and Sim Ri Kilns of Thailand, and Tuan Te Kiln of Myanmar were exported over long distance, including Penghe Island in Taiwan or Nagasaki in Japan. This small shed of a dish in the left picture was found in the Nagan site of Penghu Island. Only the upper part was covered with dirty greenish white grains. This stoneware was estimated to be a product of the Tuan Kirun from Myanmar, such as the complete one in the right picture. Jar with four handles covered natural grains on the upper part was found in Chiuran site, Iran, Taiwan. This stoneware jar was manufactured in Simbri Kirun, central Thailand, and used a match number for a container of trade commodity around 17th century, such as complete one in the right picture. Ceramic manufacturing in Thailand was concentrated in the northern area, such as Si Sachalai in the left picture. Besides Chinese influence Ceradon, Thai craftsmen produced another kind of stoneware, which is well known for its underglazed iron with an original motif, such as the covered box in the right picture. Vietnam has a long tradition of ceramic manufacturing that was influenced by China, and they made very good brand white ceramics in the 15th century. Although the condition of ceramics production was down in the 17th century, inferior Vietnamese brand white dishes were found in the Shenzhen site in Tainan, Taiwan, and Nagasaki in port in Japan. In the 15th century, the golden age of ceramic manufacturing in Vietnam, the production place was located at Chu Dao, close to Hanoi. In this area, Vietnamese craftsmen produced very fine brand white ware, such as this bottle dated 1450, and collected in the Topkapi Palace, Istanbul, as seen in the right picture. As a conclusion, we should not forget the importance of ceramic shards for the understanding of past trade networks, in particular, and past foreign relations in general. At least we can know that Taiwan was deeply connected with Southeast Asia at around the 17th century.